The artificial T-Rex puppet from Jurassic Park was just as hazardous as a genuine Tyrannosaurus Rex, nearly harming a crew member who got stuck in its intestines. So, how does it come to life? Let's talk about it. Hey guys, and welcome back to the channel. For this video, we'll be talking about how Jurassic Park robotic dinosaurs come to life. But before anything else, please leave a like on the video. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell down below so you won't miss our videos. Without further ado, let's hop on right to the video. Stan Winston Studios was chosen to build the life-size animatronics for the film based on the effects studio's prior work for James Cameron's 1986 action sci-fi picture Aliens, where the company built a life-size 14-foot-tall Norgat Man Queen puppet. Stan Winston tasked Mark McCreary with designing the ERR, which he did in collaboration with Mark Hallett, Robert Backer, and Gregory S. Paul. Stan Winston sought dynamic stances and other depictions in the concept art to express the film's non-human star's endothermy. It took an entire year to complete the concept design stage. Meanwhile, Stan Winston Studios purchased a building next door and had a section of the roof elevated 13 feet to suit the prehistoric dimensions of the full-size 20-foot-tall Mancat. Stan Winston Studios then embarked on the difficult work of creating a full-scale maquette out of modeling clay, which would be utilized in the molding of the foam latex skin that would cover the inside hydraulics. Richard Landon, the mechanical department coordinator, first produced a 16th scale maquette for color scheme concept and a 5th scale maquette to build the shape of the full-scale maquette. Richard Landon was also in charge of building the inside armature, which was made of steel and wood in the overall shape of the maquette. To give the armature shape, chicken wire was stretched over the frame, followed by fiberglass, lambs, and hardware cloth over the chicken wire. Joey Orozco, Mark Jurinko, Bill Basco, Robert Henderstein, and Greg Fiegel sculpted the primary body of the maquette out of 3 tons of Roma clay. Len Burge and Christopher Swift sculpted the legs while Michael Turkic handled the head and the neck, and the arms were sculpted independently from the body. In and of itself, sculpting the clay took 16 weeks due to the weight of the clay maquette. The outside aluminum frame that supported it had to be replaced with a steel frame. The full-scale animatronic was created by Disney Imagineer Bob Gurr, who saw right away that the project would necessitate hydraulics. Stan Winston had hoped to build the full-size Tyrannosaurus as a life-size puppet, but early tests of the idea swiftly disproved the idea. Stan Winston also planned to employ an electric motor-based system, but the electric motors available in the early 1990s couldn't provide the animatronic with the speed he desired. Stan Winston too eventually chose to use hydraulics to fully realize the figure. The animatronics designs were all made in tiny to ensure that they would work in the larger final animatronic. Richard Landon was a crucial player in the construction. Landon was in charge of the animatronics' internal mechanics and major armature fabrication. He also directed the creation of the tiny concept designs and designed the animatronics' walking rig, which allowed the legs to move independently from the body on a track. The animatronic was created on a main base of a device based on McFadden Systems designs for flight simulators, which were custom built for SWS. The animatronic would be built on top of a motion-based platform that would produce gross movements. A 4-person operated telemetry device called Wally, which was a miniaturized version of the motion-based platform, could control the platform. The floors of both the SWS shop and Stage 16, where the animatronic would be used, had to be carefully strengthened to bear the expected weight of the animatronic before either the platform or the animatronic could be created. Steel was used to build the animatronic, however, aluminum and other materials were investigated. When Stan Winston asked welder Armando Gonzalez what material would be the easiest to fix if the animatronic broke down during production, he came up with this solution. Gonzalez was also in charge of the rig's final welds, as well as buffing and dulling any sharp edges or corners on the armature that would puncture the foam latex skin that would cover the graphite fiber frame later. Spiral rings were used to build the parts of the frame that allowed for a lot of mobility, such as the neck and tail. The spiral rings, rather than the distinct circular rings used by animatronic builders at the time, did not allow the frame to slide or bunch up in spots, making it more stable. SWS connected the animatronic with an accelerometer to steady the animatronic in gross movement, which could reach 90 inches per second, because Newtonian laws still applied to the character. The skin that covered the frame was made of 2-inch thick foam rubber and was cast in parts to fit the animatronic. As a result, more foam rubber needed to be cast to fill up the gaps. In the end, the full-scale animatronic weighed 4.5 tons, was over 40 feet long, and could elevate itself 24 feet into the air, making it similar to, if not identical to, a real Tyrannosaurus Rex in size and weight. Except for the eyes, which were radio-operated, the character's 57 functions and movements were completely hydraulic. Despite Universal Studios' assurances to Stan Winston that the Tyrannosaurus rig would not be directly rained on, the animatronic wound up being soaked every day while filming the main road scene. The skin rapidly became saturated during filming because of the absorbent nature of foam rubber, causing film crews to stop shooting in order to dry the animatronic with towels. Crews would have to install fans on the animatronic overnight in order for it to dry completely in time for filming the next morning. The biggest issue with the saturation was that the animatronic's hydraulic design made it extremely vulnerable to the weight of the water. The entire setup would tremble violently if the animatronic grew too wet. The animatronic had to be weighed on a regular basis due to a frequent weight variations based on how wet or dry it was. The nightly team had to convene an emergency meeting one night when they noticed the animatronic's lower jaw had broken. Stan Winston and his staff spent the next day and a half repairing the animatronic, which meant no filming that day. Despite the water issues, the animatronic functioned admirably, allowing director Steven Spielberg to reduce the filming schedule by 4 days. A second animatronic was built solely from the waist up for close-up shots and strong interaction with the Tyrannosaurus. Because of the requirement for close-ups, the skin and the paint of this animatronic were more detailed. It had relatively limited animatronic capabilities, but it was also extremely well built. The animatronic also had a computer-based action memory that could be used to pre-program moves into the animatronics that could be replayed flawlessly several times. The Tyrannosaurus was able to push herself through the toilet hut wall without injuring Donald Gennaro inside thanks to this action memory. The Tyrannosaurus was one of the Jurassic Park franchise's most complicated sound concepts. Gary Rydstrom was tasked with finding as many original sound sources as possible in order to give the Tyrannosaurus more than just a single repetitive roar, as was the norm for previous dinosaur films. As Spielberg wished for the film to be more than another monster movie and to truly represent the dinosaurs as living animals rather than prehistoric beasts. Rydstrom captured samples from newborn elephants, alligators, lions, tigers, whales, and even from Rydstrom's personal Jack Russell Terrier, Buster, for the sound crew. The legendary Tyrannosaurus roar was made by combining the sounds of a trumpeting newborn elephant with the sounds of a Tyrannosaurus. The alligator and tiger were mixed together, resulting in growls and other rumblings. The snorting was the sound of a whale exhaling via its blowhole. When a Tyrannosaurus shook a gallimimus, it created a snarling sound like Buster playing tug of war with a rope. What do you think about this? Let us know in the comments section below. That's it for today. If you guys enjoyed the video, make sure to hit the like button. Don't forget to subscribe and turn on that notification bell so you never miss out on any future content we'll produce for you guys. We're signing off now, but we'll be sure to catch you all in the next one.